As you know, we've been frequent visitors to the Mediterranean, and one can't fail to miss the huge numbers of vineyards there are compared to the relatively few that we have in the UK. Wine is quite a normal part of life in the southern European countries, and it's usually cheap and plentiful. And remarkably, drunkenness is much less than in binging Britain. If you've ever kept a vine, you'll know that in order to produce fruit, it needs good management. You need to carefully prune it to encourage growth and to ensure it gets adequate sunlight. You need to keep an eye on it to keep it from damage by pests. In Bible times, wine was a common everyday drink necessary in warmer climates where the purity of water couldn't be guaranteed. So vines and vineyards were a part of regular life in the Middle East. And of course, we find that vines and vineyards are mentioned quite a lot in the Bible. On Sunday, I looked at the story of the fig tree that withered. And I mentioned that not only was the fig tree used as a type of Israel, but also vines and vineyards. Isaiah, referring to Israel, gave this parable about somebody who planted a vineyard. He says this: he dug it up and cleared it of stones and planted it with the choicest vines. He built a watchtower in it and cut out a wine press as well. Then he looked for a crop of good grapes, but it yielded only bad fruit. And that, of course, was God's vineyard and the fruit coming from Israel. Here's God's judgment on Judah at the time of Jeremiah. I had planted you like a choice vine of sound and reliable stock. How then did you turn against me into a corrupt wild vine? And the vineyard of God is also reflected in Psalm 80, verses 8 to 13. You transplanted a vine from Egypt. You drove out the nations and planted it. You cleared the ground for it, and it took root and filled the land. The mountains were covered with its shade, and mighty cedars with its branches. Its branches reached as far as the sea, its shoots as far as the river. Why have you broken down its walls so that all who pass by pick its grapes? Boars from the forest ravage it, and insects from the fields feed on it. We find Jesus using the picture of the vineyard in the parable of the tenants. That's where tenants kill all messengers who attempt to collect what's due from the landlord. They even kill the landlord's son. Jewish leaders knew that Jesus was drawing on the Old Testament and applying God's judgment to them, and they were furious. And against this background, Jesus says to his disciples in the upper room, I am the real vine. The unproductive vine of Israel was only a foreshadowing of the real vine, Jesus, the vine that brings forth the best grapes. And the Father is the husbandman or vine dresser who ensures by his actions that the vine is productive. So what can we say of the real vine or true vine as it says in some translations? First of all, Jesus says, I am the real vine. I am the true vine. He talks about himself of being the vine. Israel corporately was compared to being a vine in the Old Testament. But in contrast, we as God's people in Christ find our focus is Jesus and our life comes from him. As we come to communion this evening, we're not marking our communion with one another, even though it's nice to see you all. We're here to affirm our communion with Jesus as we remember his body broken and his blood shed. The focus of our lives should be, and I hope is, Jesus himself. The second thing we learn from this passage is that we are the branches. We're his disciples. And Jesus says, I'm the true vine and you're the branches. And as branches, we exist to bear fruit because it's from the branches, obviously, where the fruit hangs from. During the long periods of lockdown in the last 12 months, we've come to understand the importance that we are to one another as God's people. And I've explored that in my previous series. But to push along with the vine analogy, we produce fruit because as branches, we're all fruitful in producing the grapes and the foliage because the underlying vine brings us all the various nutrients to create them. Without the actual vine, nothing can exist because the vine has all the structure in it to provide all the nutrients for growth. And the vine also supports the whole thing from the ground and provides water from its roots. Jesus has given us an important role as his branches, but without connection to Jesus himself, the vine, we're absolutely nothing. Someone has said that without Jesus, a vine would be nothing more than a pile of dead twigs, the sort that's only good for kindling a fire. That's the second lesson of lockdown that we should have discovered by now. Without Jesus, we don't function because we can't. If we stop praying, if we stop reading God's word, if we stop meeting to worship, we can still do it online, as you know, and if we stop having fellowship, we can still do a little bit of that online as well. If we stop connecting with God, then we cease to be fruitful and we're going to wither away spiritually. And we're hoping that by the end of the pandemic, that rather than seeing a whole lot of people that are wilting spiritually, we might see and realize those that, even though we couldn't do all our normal stuff, still realized that we're connected to the vine and receive our feeding from the Lord Jesus Christ. When we start to wither away spiritually, we become unfruitful and good for nothing. It brings us nothing but guilt, struggle, depression, despair, fear, hopelessness. And our loving Father doesn't want us to be like this at all. He wants us to thrive and be fruitful, to stay connected to the vine. Are you struggling now? Are you struggling in your faith, particularly because of the isolation of lockdown? You're by no means alone. It's important to share your loneliness with others who you trust, who'll pray for you, who'll encourage you. We might not be able to meet face to face, but we can still remain in touch. We can remain in touch online, by phone, by letter, whatever. Stay in touch. Find those who'll encourage you and find those who'll pray for you. Most importantly, come before Jesus and ask him to fully connect you with all the spiritual resources that the Holy Spirit can bring you, because he's within you and he can keep you connected to the vine. The third thing that comes out of this passage is that we need cleaning regularly. Jesus said, "I am the true vine and my Father is the gardener. He cuts off every branch in me that bears no fruit, while every branch that does bear fruit, he prunes so that it'll be even more fruitful. You are already clean because of the word I've spoken to you." We come to communion this evening and we need to realize right at the start that we're fit to be in the presence of God, as Jesus said in the last sentence, because we've trusted in the Lord Jesus Christ already. And the death of Jesus was sufficient to deal with all the issues of sin. We've been forgiven, we've been cleansed, and now we live his risen life. That's already happened. The job of the vine dresser, the gardener, is to prune the branches to ensure that most fruit gets produced. Sometimes vines have to be heavily pruned and don't look very nice. But I tell you what, come the next growing season, the branches come back all the more impressively, all the more strongly. Never see the tough times in life that you go through as being a total wipeout. sometimes they're our own fault. Sometimes, like the pandemic, they're mostly out of our control. All those times, even when we mess up ourselves, are opportunities to learn, so we come back all the more strongly. Pray this morning that you'll learn lessons from that God wants to teach you through these difficult times. As I've said for the last 13 years of my ministry here, we have a God who takes our minuses and turns them to pluses. We may look a bit of a mess after hard times, roll on the opening of hairdressers, but God can use whatever mess we're in spiritually to make us come back even stronger. Pray that God's Spirit may do a new work in each of us so that we allow him to take from us the failure, the anger, the fear, the frustration, the loneliness and the struggle as we confess it to him, and that he'll clean us up and prune us ready for new growth so that we may walk forward in faith all the more joyously and all the more fruitfully. Finally, we need to remain in him to bear fruit. If Jesus is the real deal, we need to remain in him. I know there are many of you who found that in the absence of familiar church during the pandemic, you've found yourself reaffirming that the most important thing to do when everything seems to be falling around you is to remain in Christ, to abide in him. In a world that changes, and sometimes not for the better, Jesus remains as that rock, that true vine who gives us all the spiritual sustenance to continue to abide in him and to bear fruit. As we come around the table this evening, let's affirm our need of him as we come to this prayer of confession. So let's pray, shall we? Father, thank you that through faith we've become added to the vine that is your Son, Jesus, who lived, who died, and who's risen again and brought us new life in him. Lord Jesus, we confess before you that in the last few months it's been a bit of a struggle. So help us to fully connect us to all the spiritual resources through the Holy Spirit within us. Help us to support one another in that and encourage one another. Please forgive us where we've not sought to abide in you closely. Please turn our minuses to pluses, that in dealing with our fears, failures, lack of faith or whatever, we may be pruned ready for more fruit. May your Spirit bring us back more powerfully and do a new work in us. In all things, Father, give us the strength to remain in Jesus, so in the new times to come, we may produce much spiritual fruit. We ask this in Jesus' name and for his glory. Amen.